Hi, mamas, and welcome to this very special edition of Mental Health Mondays. So today we are celebrating Mother's Day, but in celebrating, I want you each to recognize that I know and we hear you when you say that not all Mother's Days are celebratory. So even though we want to celebrate you and all of the care and attention you give to your children and what it takes to be a mom, it can also bring up some really difficult emotions when you are managing the only relationship that you might be having with your own mother or mother-in-law. So those of you that are approaching Mother's Day feeling apprehensive, feeling dreadful, this topic is for you. So when you think about loved ones that you have in your life that tend to cause you pain, a lot of us in our life have been trained that, well, maybe I can fix them. Maybe this is the time that they will change and that they will listen and they will take accountability. And maybe ever since you were a little kid, you've operated with the idea of, if I do this, then they won't act this way, right? Kind of X plus Y equals Z equation in your mind. And perhaps it's something that you have been managing your entire life. If I avoid doing this, then this will happen, or this won't happen. And this is so much of a trauma response. And I want to just give some attention to those of you that have had difficult relationships with your mom or either parent, or maybe even a mother-in-law or a grandmother, some sort of mother figure, where you were always planning and preparing and trying to control a situation so that maybe mom, grandma, whomever it was, wouldn't react in the same way, in the same way that maybe is hurtful to them, hurtful to you, or to both. And so many, many, many clients that we see come to therapy because they have realized that maybe they finally have come to the realization that they can't change the person, they can't control the person, and they have to learn how to adapt. We even work on these skills with young children, children as young as, you know, 9 years old, saying, you know what, mom or dad may not change. And so what do you have to do in order to adapt? And one of the most important things that we teach adult children or even younger children dealing with a difficult mother is boundaries. And if you just had a reaction when I said the word boundaries, it's probably because you know that you need stronger ones. Now, when we're dealing with difficult people, boundaries are there to protect us, but they are difficult to maintain. Many people will say, well, the easiest thing is to cut them out of your life. That actually is incredibly difficult to do. And those that have done it have known that that is the only way that they can maintain a boundary. And so you have options. You have the option of establishing strict boundaries and practicing them and continuing to enforce them, which will take constant attention and constant gut checking with yourself. Or you have the option of instilling a boundary that says, you know what, that's it. I can't have you in my life anymore. Both are difficult, both are important. So when you are considering establishing boundaries that allow you to still have a relationship, but on your terms, that's when you're going to want to check in with yourself. Okay, questions to ask yourself. When I set this boundary, what can I anticipate feeling? And usually one of the most pronounced emotions that you will feel is guilt. And the guilt is not a real emotion or feeling, it is a story. And typically that guilt then has to do with some sort of shame or fear or self-limiting belief that has been around for a long time. And so if you recognize that guilt is one of your dominant feelings, when you start to set boundaries with a loved one like your own mother or a mother-in-law, ask yourself, where did this first story come up? Why might I be feeling shame or maybe some fear? What were you told when you were a child, when you did something differently than what was expected of you, when you disobeyed, when you chose you instead of that person, when you chose not to take care of that person or try to save them or help them? What happened? And we have to understand our childhood and those traumas and those instances where we were shamed or, criticized, judged, punished for choosing ourselves first or for doing something that maybe made this person look bad in their own mind. It's important to dig back and to look at what happened so that you can understand where your guilt story comes from, because again, it's a story. And then you have to ask yourself, well, if I repeat this, if I do this again, will the same outcome happen? And you might say, absolutely, yeah. I'm gonna get reprimanded. I'm gonna be treated like I was 9 years old again. I'm gonna be told that I'm, an embarrassment, or I'm gonna be told that I'm selfish. Okay, prepare for that. And then ask yourself, are any of those things true? Are those things true? And usually the answer is no. But you can still then feel the guilt, right? Well, if I did something differently, maybe I could finally make her happy. If I did something differently, maybe she finally wouldn't react in that same way. Maybe there wouldn't be the explosion. Maybe she would finally make a better choice. That's all an illusion of control. And so the most important thing when you start to set boundaries is recognizing that I'm doing this to protect me. I'm doing this to help me. I'm doing this to save myself. Because the amount of energy that you put towards trying to help someone else who cannot be helped, you've tried. Remember that you've tried. You've tried for however many years to try and save or help that other person. And how has it destroyed you? So, setting that boundary of no, I will not come over to your house. No, I will not see you on Mother's Day. No, I will not go get your groceries. No, I will not answer the phone when you call me. You have to set things up on your own terms, but you are capable of being able to operate within. It can be as simple as, I'm only going to call you on certain days when I feel prepared. I will not answer the phone. I will not answer the phone when this person calls. I will only listen to a voicemail, maybe, and call back. But you have to figure out what those boundaries are that you can feel comfortable with. It will take practice, but that feels like you have more control on how the relationship goes. And you can choose a boundary, could be, I'm only going to be surface level with you. I'm not going to share anything about my life. I'm not going to go into details because I don't trust you with having that information. I don't trust you with being immersed in my life. But then the important thing is that following through and following up. Having an accountability partner, someone that you can work with and say, all right, I made a decision and I recognize that I made it out of guilt, fear, shame. I didn't make it out of self-love. I didn't make it out of a loving and compassionate place. I made it out of guilt, fear, or shame. Maybe that's your partner. Maybe that's a sibling. Maybe that's a best friend. When dealing with this difficult person, you have to recognize where your intention's coming from. And if they're coming out of guilt, fear, or shame, then you know that you've already let your boundaries down. Let them be coming out of self-love, self-compassion. The selfishness that you've probably been shamed for operating out of before, which is why it's going to feel really hard to put up that boundary. Recognize that boundaries are difficult. They are not an easy thing to first institute. It comes with practice over and over and over again, and then having to sit in the discomfort of, ooh, I feel like I disappointed someone, or ooh, I feel like there might be a consequence here, embracing yourself for it. Oh, gosh, it's exhausting. But the more that you can be steadfast with it, the easier this whole process will get. And then you're anticipating a result. And that result, honestly, when you're able to act with more humor about it, like, oh, of course that happened. Yeah, of course she reacted that way. I could have expected that. Or I'm already expecting that. Okay, it has nothing to do with you and everything to do with them. This is heavy work, and I wish that I could answer all the questions and help you all with your relationships with your mothers right now. It takes time to uncover the traumas, to recognize that you didn't do this to you. These things happened. You were a child more often than not. And now, as an adult, it's figuring out how do you put yourself first? How do you protect yourself? How do you make choices that might feel hard, but are the most important choices you can make? And some of those might mean completely eliminating someone from your life, which is really, really, really hard. So if any of you have made that decision already, you are so courageous, and you should recognize how much work that takes and diligence. If you feel like you have work to do on this, you have a relationship you really need to flesh out, reach out to a therapist, reach out to someone that, you know, can really walk alongside you in recognizing all of the stories that you've been telling yourself, all of the limiting beliefs, all of the guilt and the shame and the fear, and how to empower you to recognize that you cannot fix this person, you cannot save them, no matter how many times you try. It's exhausting for you. So I feel you. This is a hard one. When Mother's Day comes, please celebrate you. Celebrate all you are doing for yourself and for your kiddos, the incredible mother that you are, and that if you are even paying attention a little bit, you are stopping the cycle of intergenerational trauma. You will not repeat these patterns and make your children deal with them when they are an adult. Celebrate the fact that you are aware and you are working on your stuff. All right, mamas. Till next time.